Hello, welcome back. Today we'll be starting the first lecture on Kamal's video e-lecture on pediatric cardiology. The first lecture basically is the approach to congenital heart disease. In this lecture, we will be discussing about how to diagnose if the child has a congenital heart disease or not, and how to differentiate the different types of the congenital heart diseases on the basis and whether to put it as a cyanotic condition or a acyanotic condition. Before I move towards the approach to congenital heart disease, we should be aware of what cyanosis and acyanotic heart diseases will constitute. So a saturation which is more than 94%, more than equal to 94% in the room air will be a acyanotic condition, whereas if the saturation of the child or the adult, if it is less than equal to 93% in room air, will be a cyanotic condition. But our eyes are able to pick up those saturations which are less than 85%. So a saturation which is varying between 85% to 93%, although it can only be picked up with a saturation probe, we cannot pick up from our naked eyes. So a saturation which is below 85% will be picked up by our naked eyes. First point. So to differentiate cyanotics and acyanotics, this point should be clear in our mind. The second point which needs to be cleared is like to see the important point is to differentiate if the child is having a cyanotic heart disease or not. The age-old criteria which we all are aware of is the NADAS criteria. We often forget it, but the criteria needs to be very much remembered. Before moving forwards, I will ask you all to keep a copy and a pen with you so that you can jot down the points and make a series of notes with it, because I am not showing any slides, but I'll be going very slowly so that you can jot down the points and I will be revising and re-revising. So the first important point which I have just told is what is cyanosis. Any saturation which is less than equal to 93%. It is less than equal to. That means 93 is included. And a saturation which is below 85% will be picked up with our naked eyes. A saturation which is more than equal to 94% will be normal in room air. So the first question arises. Is the child having a congenital heart disease or not? So the criteria which needs to be fulfilled for this is the age-old criteria, the NADAS criteria. NADAS criteria. So there are major points and minor points in NADAS criteria. There are 4 major and 5 minor points in NADAS criteria. The major points which are there in NADAS criteria are: first of all, any systolic murmur which is of grade 3 or more, like it means that grade 1 and 2 systolic murmurs are not included in the major criteria of NADAS. Second point, any diastolic murmur of any grade. Ideally, the diastolic murmurs are not graded. So any diastolic murmur of any grade will be a major criteria. Third is cyanosis. A child which is having cyanosis will be put in the major criteria of NADAS. Fourth is CHF, congestive heart failure. So if these are the major criteria, first is any systolic murmur of grade 3 or more, any diastolic murmur, cyanosis and CHF. These are the 4 major criteria of NADAS. There are 5 minor criteria of NADAS, which includes: first of all, you have to see the examination points. 2 points are there in examination. Rather, 3 I should say. First is you will see the vitals of the child. So pick up the blood pressure from that. So the blood pressure is abnormal. Abnormal blood pressure. Second, you will put your stent and see for S2, second heart sound. So there will be abnormality in the second heart sound. It can be of any sort. So abnormal second heart sound. Third is your stent is already on the chest and you are getting any systolic murmur of grade 1 or 2. So grade 1 and 2 systolic murmur will come into the minor criteria of NIDAS. Remember that we have rejected from major criteria. Only grade 3 and above were in the major criteria, whereas in minor criteria, on the other hand, we have grade 1 and 2 systolic murmurs. Now you have done the examination, two minor criteria are from investigations. That will be abnormal ECG or an abnormal chest X-ray. So the five minor criteria are abnormal blood pressure, abnormal second heart sound, abnormal systolic murmur of grade 1 and 2, then you have chest X-ray abnormality or a ECG abnormality. These are the five criteria. So to diagnose a child with congenital heart disease, you need major criteria or minor criteria to suspect, rather it should not be diagnosed, it should be suspect. So that this was made in the era when echo was not available. Nowadays echo is available, but the clinics have to be kept in mind. So to suspect a child with congenital heart disease, you need one major criteria, or it is or not and, or two minor criteria to suspect a child with congenital heart disease. So with this NIDAS criteria, you can suspect this child with congenital heart disease. So you have suspected a child with congenital heart disease. It is fulfilling one major or two minor criteria of NIDAS. Now there are five basic questions which needs to be answered for this congenital heart disease, and you should jot them down one by one. These are very much important for the diagnosis and further management of these congenital heart diseases. So after you have suspected a child to be of congenital heart disease, you should see that whether the child is cyanotic or acyanotic. The first question is, child is cyanotic or acyanotic. We already know what is cyanosis and what is acyanosis. The second question which needs to be answered in both of these, is there a increased pulmonary blood flow situation or not? Second condition is increased pulmonary blood flow situation or not. The third question which needs to be answered is if there is any pulmonary arterial hypertension. If there is any pulmonary arterial hypertension. The fourth point which needs to be answered is that is the malformation arising in the left side of the heart or the right side of the heart. So this is very important. You should be aware of that the pathology is in the left side of the heart or the right side of the heart. The fifth point which needs to be answered is which is the dominant ventricle, which is the ventricle of dominance. So you have to answer these five points after fulfilling the NIDAS criteria. I will again repeat these five points. First is after you have fulfilled that the child has a congenital heart disease, you will move towards if the condition is acyanotic or cyanotic. After the second question which needs to be answered is there is an increased arterial blood flow or a decreased arterial blood flow. Third is if there is PAH or not. Fourth is where is the pathology arising from the left heart or the right heart. The fifth is what is the dominant ventricle. So these are the things which needs to be kept in mind. Now you have to see for the first question. Is the condition cyanotic or acyanotic? So based on the saturation of the child, if the saturation is more than equal to 94%, we will put the child under acyanotic condition. If the saturation of the child is less than equal to 93%, the child will be in the cyanotic criteria. So the first question will be answered easily. But we have to move around and go inside to see what all cyanotic conditions or acyanotic conditions are there in store for us. So first we will see for those situations which have a saturation of more than equal to 94% in room air. So before moving into the acyanotics and cyanotics, I would add a side clip in it that there is something called hyperoxia test. There is something called hyperoxia test. This is an age old test which was being done to differentiate if the child is cyanotic due to cardiac causes or due to respiratory causes or due to CNS causes. So to differentiate these, there is a test called hyperoxia test. What was being done in that case, that the child who is a cyanotic child and the saturation is less than equal to 93%, we will give 100% oxygen to this child for 10 minutes, 100% oxygen to this child for 10 minutes and then take out the ABG of this child. You have to take out the ABG before doing this test and then take out the ABG of this child after doing this. The thing which is to be observed in this ABG is not the SpO2. You have to see for the PaO2s. So if the PO2 has risen to more than 150 to 200, it is a respiratory cause of cyanosis. Whereas if the PaO2s have not risen more than 150, then it will be a cyanotic heart disease is the cause. Because the respiratory causes, they will increase their PaO2s, whereas the heart disease won't be able to increase their PaO2s beyond 150. Remember, one important point in this is SpO2 is not to be taken as a criteria for this test. SpO2 is not to be taken as a criteria for this test. So, moving on to our basic question, is the condition cyanotic or acyanotic? We have answered that. So, we will see the acyanotic conditions which are there and the cyanotic conditions which are there. So, when we think of acyanotic conditions, first of all, we should have three things in mind. The acyanotic conditions can arise due to shunt lesions, obstructive lesions, regurgitant lesions. So these are shunt lesions, obstructive lesions and regurgitant lesions. Most of the time when the students are asked of acyanotic conditions, they just think of the shunt lesions. The answers which comes out from them is ASD, VSD and PDA. But mind you, we have lot more. It is approximately 15 to 20 diseases are there which are acyanotic congenital heart diseases. So you have to answer it in this manner. First is the shunt lesion, second is the regurgitant lesion, third is the obstructive lesion. So moving on to the shunt lesions, we will describe the shunt lesion first. The first thing of acyanotic congenital heart disease, the shunt lesion. For the shunt lesions, you have to describe those lesions which are above the tricuspid wall and we will call them as pre-tricuspid shunts. And those which are below the tricuspid wall, we will call them as post-tricuspid shunts. They have been divided into pre-tricuspid shunts and post-tricuspid shunts based on the hemodynamics. With regards to the hemodynamics of these different lesions, we will discuss them in our next lecture. We will be discussing in this lecture their approach and classification basically. Otherwise, the lecture will be endless. So, for the shunt lesions, you have to divide it into two parts, pre-tricuspid and post-tricuspid. So, for the pre-tricuspid shunts, the lesions which we have is, just jot them down, are ASDs. So, these ASDs will be of four types, in which all of the four types of ASDs will be in pre-tricuspid shunts. The sinus venosus ASD, which is the most common ASD. The ostium primum ASD, the second most common ASD. The coronary sinus type of ASDs. And the ostium secundum ASDs. The most common type of ASD is the ostium secundum ASD, which constitutes for around 70%. Second is the ostium primum ASD, which constitutes for around 15 to 20%. Third is the sinus venosus ASD, which includes both the SVC type and the IVC type, which is around less than 10%, and the least common is the coronary sinus type of ASDs, which is less than 2 to 3%. So these four types of ASDs will come into pre-tricuspid shunt. Next pre-tricuspid shunt will be PAPVC, which is partial anomalous pulmonary venous communication. This is a condition in which 1, 2 or 3 pulmonary veins will drain anomalously into a tributary or into the RA, into tributary of RA or into that RA directly. It should not be all 4, because if all 4s are draining, it will be total anomalous pulmonary venous communication. So either 1, 2, or 3 pulmonary veins will be draining either into the IVC, into the SVC, into the coronary sinus, or directly into RA, making it to be PAPVC, which will act as a pre-tricuspid shunt. The third tricuspid shunt will be RSOV, ruptured sinus of Valsalva, rupturing into RA. Ruptured sinus of Valsalva, rupturing into RA will be the third one. The fourth will be coronary cameral fistula, which is rupturing into the RA. This will be the fourth tricuspid shunt. Coronary cameral fistula rupturing into the RA. The fifth tricuspid shunt will be the aorto RA tunnel. So these are the examples of some of the pre-tricuspid shunts. I'll repeat them. ASD, all four types of ASD, including ostium secundum, ostium primum, sinus venosus, coronary sinus. Second was PAPVC, partial anomalous pulmonary venous communication. Third was RSOV, ruptured sinus of Valsalva into RA. Fourth is coronary cameral fistula into RA. Fifth is aorto RA tunnel. So these will be pre-tricuspid shunts. Moving on to the post-tricuspid shunts, the shunts which are after the tricuspid wall. The first and the most important is our most common congenital heart disease is the VSD, ventricular septal defect. Post-tricuspid shunt, the first is VSD, ventricular septal defect. Second is AVSD, AV septal defect. AVSD, AV septal defect. Third will be PDA, patent ductus arteriosus. Third will be PDA, patent ductus arteriosus. Fourth will be AP window, aortopulmonary window. AP window, aortopulmonary window. Fifth will be RSOV, rupturing into RV. RSOV, rupturing into RV. Sixth will be coronary cameral fistula, rupturing into RV. Coronary cameral fistula, rupturing into RV. Seventh will be aorto-RV tunnel, aorto-RV tunnel. So these are the 7 post-tricuspid shunts which you should be aware of. I'll repeat them. It will be VST, AVST, PDA, AP window, RSOV rupturing into RV, coronary cameral fistula into RV, and aorto-RV tunnel. So we have read about the shunt lesions which will be pre-tricuspid and post-tricuspid. The second lesion which we have to think about are the regurgitant lesions. The second acyanotic lesions will be the regurgitant lesion, which includes, we have 4 walls in our heart. So the regurgitation occurring in any of these 4 walls will lead to a heart disease called the acyanotic congenital heart disease. It can be TR, it can be PR, it can be AR, it can be MR. So all the 4 walls can regurgitate, making it a regurgitant lesion. The third group of acyanotic heart diseases which we have is the obstructive lesions. Obstructive lesions can be in the form of the walls getting obstructed. Sorry. Like we can have mitral stenosis, we can have aortic stenosis making hypoplastic left heart syndrome. On the right side we can have tricuspid stenosis or we can have pulmonary stenosis. So these obstructive lesions will be acting as a cyanotic congenital heart disease. Obstructive lesions also constitutes coarctation of aorta also. So these will be conditions of obstructive lesions of a cyanotic congenital heart disease. So in a cyanotic congenital heart disease, what did we read? We read about the shunt lesions, the obstructive lesions, the regurgitant lesions. In the shunt lesion, we saw both the pre-tricuspid and the post-tricuspid shunt. In obstructive lesions, all the 4 walls were seen and their obstructions along with coarctation of aorta. In the regurgitant lesion, we talked about the 4 walls and them getting regurgitated. So now we will move on to the cyanotic congenital heart diseases. Cyanotic congenital heart diseases will be those conditions in which the saturation will be less than equal to 93%. So we describe the cyanotic congenital heart diseases into 5 categories, which will be divided into, first is the cyanotic congenital heart diseases with decreased pulmonary blood flow. Those cyanotic congenital heart diseases with decreased pulmonary blood flow are subdivided into VSD-PS physiology and Eisenmenger's physiology. The second cyanotic congenital heart diseases will be described as those with increased pulmonary blood flow. So those with increased pulmonary blood flow, we have two subgroups. Those are called the admixture physiology or the transposition physiology. And the last is those with normal pulmonary blood flow and miscellaneous group. So these are constitute our five groups. So the five groups of cyanotic congenital heart diseases are VSD-PS physiology, Eisenmenger's physiology, these two being in the decreased pulmonary blood flow. Those next two will be in increased pulmonary blood flow. These will be admixture physiology and transposition physiology. Fifth one will be like normal pulmonary blood flow and having miscellaneous flow. So we'll describe all of them one by one. So first disease which we said was those with decreased pulmonary blood flow, and in that VSD-PS physiology. So this VSD-PS physiology basically means the VSD should be unrestrictive. It means that the VSD should be large enough to keep the pressure of the RV and the LV to be equal. And there should be pulmonary stenosis. Pulmonary stenosis can be in the form of infundibular stenosis or valvular stenosis. So basically there should be a large VSD with decreased pulmonary blood flow. The prototype of this group we all know is TOF, Tetralogy of Fallot. So the prototype of this group will be TOF, which is called the Tetralogy of Fallot. The other conditions which are called as TOF equivalents will be DORV-VSD-PS. DORV-VSD-PS is double outlet right ventricle with VSD, which means unrestricted VSD and a PS. The third will be DTGA-VSD-PH, de-looped transposition of gate arteries with VSD-PS. The fourth will be CCTGA-VSD-PS, which includes congenitally corrected TGA with PS. The fifth will be tricuspid atresias, those are having VSD with PS. Tricuspid atresias can be of various types. So those tricuspid atresias which are having a large VSD and PS, that will be the fifth group. The sixth will be single ventricle with PS. Sixth will be single ventricle with PS. The seventh will be AV septal defect, AVSD is with PS. Remember, AVSD was a cyanotic condition, but if it is associated with PS and a large inlet VSD, then it will be coming under this category. This is the seventh group. And the eighth group will be truncus with peripheral branch pulmonary artery stenosis. Truncus with peripheral branch pulmonary artery stenosis. So the condition which we have described in this group of VSD, PS and those having decreased pulmonary blood flow are TOF and its equivalents. Equivalents includes DORV-VSD-PS, DTGA-VSD-PS, CCTGA-VSD-PS, single ventricle PS, tricuspid atresias, those having a large VSD and PS, truncus with small peripheral pulmonary arteries which are having stenosis, and the 8 AVSD with PS. Those conditions which do not come into VSD-PS physiology, but they come under the group of decreased pulmonary blood flow, some additional conditions are there, like pulmonary atresia with intact ventricular septum, write them John, pulmonary atresia with intact ventricular septum, ASD with PS, which will cause the shunting of the blood from the right to the left, and Epstein's anomaly, the severe form in which functional PS can occur. So the conditions which are in the decreased pulmonary blood flow, but they do not directly come into the VSD-PS physiology, will be pulmonary atresia, intact ventricular septum, ASD with PS, and extreme forms of Epstein's anomaly having functional PS. Move on to the cyanotic congenital heart group with the second category. The second category was the Eisenmenger's category, which will have decreased pulmonary blood flow. So this Eisenmenger will have those in which the sinuses have occurred due to increased pulmonary, initially it was an increased pulmonary blood flow which led to hyperkinetic PAH, and later it led to the histological changes in the pulmonary vasculature making it a fixed obstructive PAH and leading into the reversal of the shunt. So this will be the Eisenmenger syndrome. Moving on to the third category, the third and the fourth category will be of increased pulmonary blood flow. The increased pulmonary blood flow had been divided into the third, which was admixture physiology, and the fourth, which was the transposition physiology. So first of all, take the admixture physiology. Admixture physiology basically means that there is a mixing of the blood of the pure and the impure, that is the blue and the red blood. So the admixture of the blood can occur at the level of above the atria. It can be at the level of atria, it can be at the level of the ventricle, or it can be at the level of the great arteries. So the admixture which occurs above the level of the atria will be called as TAPVC, that is total anomalous pulmonary venous communication, because in this cases all the pulmonary veins will be joining either the SVC or the IVC or the coronary sinus, that is above the level of the atria. Remember that PAPVC was pre-tricuspid shunt. We read that three pulmonary veins, one, two or three pulmonary veins, if they are joining into any of these, will lead to an acyanotic condition, which is called the PAPVC, partial anomalous pulmonary venous communication. Whereas TAPVC, total anomalous pulmonary venous communication, will be a cyanotic condition, because all the pulmonary blood is going into the right heart, either through the SVC or the IVC or the coronary sinus, which is above the atria. And coming under the second admixture lesion, which is the at the level of the atria. At the level of atria, you can either have a common atrium or a single atrium. You can have a tricuspid atresia, because the mixing is occurring at the level of atria, because the tricuspid valve is atretic. The blood cannot go from RA to RV. It has to mix at the level of atria to enter into the LA and then go into the LV, and then through the VSD into RV if it is there. Second, and the third will be hypoplastic left heart syndrome. The thing which we are talking about, tricuspid atresia, that is the hypoplastic right heart syndrome, will apply for the left heart also. So the mixing is required at the level of the atria. So the mixing at the atrial level will be at the level of common atrium or a single atrium. It can be tricuspid atresia or a total anomalous hypoplastic left heart syndrome. Mixing at the level of the ventricle, third admixture lesion, will be single ventricle. Mixing at the level of ventricle will be a single ventricle. Those, in those conditions in which the mixing is occurring at the level of the great arteries beyond the ventricles, is, we all know, truncus arteriosus. So in the case of admixture lesion, mixing can be at the level of above atria. Example is TAPVC at the level of atria. The example is common atrium, single atrium, tricuspid atresia, hypoplastic left heart syndrome. At the level of the ventricle, single ventricle, at the level of the great arteries, making them truncus arteriosus. Moving on to the fourth group of the cyanotic condition, which will be called as the transposition physiology, in which there is transposition of the great arteries. In this, two groups comes, which is the DTGA and the tossing Bing anomaly. The first is the DTGA and the second is the tossing Bing anomaly. Tossing Bing anomaly is a type of DORV in which there is subpulmonic VST, tossing Bing. So the physiology which it attains is the TGA physiology, transposition physiology. Moving into the fifth category of congenital heart disease, those who are having near normal pulmonary blood flow or the miscellaneous group and are having cyanosis will be the unroofed coronary sinus, which is draining into the LA causing cyanosis, anomalous drainage of the vena cava into the LA or the pulmonary AV fistula. So near normal pulmonary blood flows will be in unroofed coronary sinus, total anomalous systemic venous drainage or the pulmonary AV fistula. So we have read about the classification of the acyanotic and the cyanotic congenital heart diseases. In the acyanotic heart diseases, we read about three conditions: the shunt lesions making it into pre-tricuspid, post-tricuspid, the obstructive lesions causing obstruction at all the four walls or the coarctation of aorta, the regurgitant lesions causing regurgitation of the four walls. Moving on to the cyanotic diseases, which said, we read about five cyanotic conditions, those with decreased pulmonary blood flow, including VSDPS physiology, decreased pulmonary blood flow with Eisenmenger's physiology, increased pulmonary blood flow of admixture physiology, increased pulmonary blood flow of transposition physiology, normal pulmonary blood flow of miscellaneous physiology. I hope you all have understood this. So if you have done this part, then you will have to look into the second part, which the second question which we had was, is there increased pulmonary blood flow or not? So how do we suspect by history that if there is increased pulmonary blood flow or not? So there will be chances of increased pulmonary blood flow if there are signs and symptoms of CHF in a child. So the child will have repeated respiratory chest infections, first of all. So a question arises, what do we call the chest infections to be repeated. So a chest infection is, it should be a lower respiratory tract infection. It should not be URI, and it should be at least 2 episodes in 1 year or 3 episodes any time in the life will be called as repeated, and there should be X-ray clearance between the 2 episodes. So 2 episodes in 1 year or more than 2 episodes any time in the life with X-ray clearance in them will be called as, between them will be called as repeated chest infection. So if the child is having repeated chest infections, LRTI, hospitalizations, needing IV antibiotics, so it will be called as increased pulmonary blood flow. These children will have excessive forehead sweating, they will have suck, rest, suck cycle, they won't be drinking the mother, sucking the breast continuously, they will have excessive sweating, they will have failure to thrive, they won't be growing as per their peers. So these are the signs of congestive heart failure. These children will be tachypneic, they can have tachycardia, even right heart failure signs like hepatomegaly can be there. So by these we can know that the pulmonary blood flow is increased. The third question which comes into our mind is, does the malformation originate in the left or the right side of the heart? So you have to be clear if the malformation is arising in the left side of the heart or the right side of the heart. So if the malformation is arising in the left side of the heart, you will have more of congestive features, pulmonary congestive features, like the child will have lung plethoric, lung fields congestion, venous congestion will be there. Whereas those arising in the right side of the heart, they will have hepatomegaly, edema, sacral edema or the pedal edema. The fourth question which comes into mind is if there is a pulmonary hypertension or not. So pulmonary hypertension basically can be of two types. It can be due to the flow related. If the flow is basically, what you need to understand in this is like, what is pressure? Pressure means it's a product of flow and resistance. Pressure is equal to flow into R, flow and resistance. So the pressure in the pulmonary vasculature will increase if there is excess flow or if the resistance of the pulmonary vessels have increased. So what happens if there is, in the initial part of these shunt lesions, what happens is that the flow increases, so the pressure increases. The pressure in the pulmonary vasculature, which is called the PAH, if it increases due to the increase in the flow, it is called as hyperkinetic PAH. Because if the flow is stopped or flow is decreased, then these changes, this pressure will come down. So it's not permanent thing. The second thing, if this flow keeps on going for a long time, they will make histological changes in the small vessels of the pulmonary vessels. So these will lead to obstructive features and these will lead to obstruction. So as we read, that pressure is equal to flow into resistance. So now the second part is increasing. If the resistance increases, the pressure again increases, pH will be there. But the most important point to understand at this point is that if the resistance has increased, we cannot reverse it. So it cannot be reversed. So the pH needs to be controlled in the hyperactive phase only. It cannot be controlled in the obstructive phase. So you have to be clear on this aspect, because if the child is in hyperkinetic pH state, you can decrease this flow by closing the shunt either with a device or by surgical closure. Whereas if the child has reached in a state of obstructive pH, you cannot reverse it. You cannot close it, because if you close it, this child will act as a primary pH, which has a worse prognosis than if left alone at this stage, which will act as an Eisenmenger. The 10-year survival of an Eisenmenger will be nearing around 70-80%, whereas the 10-year survival of a primary pH will be very less, which will be nearing around 30% only. So you should not close it with of these shunt lesions, either by device or surgery, not to be closed ever. So the fifth question which arises is, which is the dominant ventricle? You have to be clear in that. So for the dominance of the ventricles, to see, you have to see by clinically, by X-ray and by ECG. So the acyanotic conditions which we were talking about, the pre-tricuspid shunts will produce a RV dominance, RV apex. The pre-tricuspid shunt will produce a RV dominance, the RV apex, whereas the post-tricuspid shunts will produce a LV dominance. The obstructive lesions of the right side will produce a RV apex, whereas obstructive lesions of the left side will produce a LV apex. Moving on to the cyanotic congenital heart diseases, you have to be very sure of the apex in these types. So as we have described them, we will be describing, I think you must be noting down all the points, so you should note these, because I do not have any slides to show them to you. So the cyanotic congenital heart diseases with decreased pulmonary blood flow, we will describe the decreased pulmonary blood flow into three parts, with RV dominance, with LV dominance, with biventricular dominance. Just a general rule I am giving in you, that all the cyanotic congenital heart diseases will have a RV dominance. We have five exceptions to this rule. We will have all the cyanotic congenital heart diseases with RV dominance, with just five exceptions to this rule. The exceptions are those with tricuspid atresia, they will have a LV dominance. Single ventricle, mostly, because most of the single ventricles, they will have a LV dominance, because 85% of the single ventricle is of LV morphology. Pulmonary atresia, intact septum will be of LV morphology. Then you will have AVCD with VSDPS will have LV morphology, and Epstein's anomaly will have a LV apex. So we have five conditions of cyanotic congenital heart diseases which do not have RV dominance. Otherwise, you can put all other into RV dominance. The five conditions which are exception to the cyanotic heart disease with RV dominance, that is, they are not having RV dominance, are tricuspid atresia, pulmonary atresia intact septum, AVCD with PS, Epstein's anomaly, as we have said, and single ventricle with VSDPS, because most of the single ventricles are of LV morphology. So these will be having. So just to jot down the points, you can write those with decreased pulmonary blood flow with RV dominance, they will be having TOF and TOF physiology. Decreased pulmonary blood flow with LV dominance will be tricuspid atresia with PS types of tricuspid atresia, and pulmonary atresia with intact ventricular septum. Those having biventricular dominance will be truncus arteriosus, because truncus arteriosus will have a large VSD. Moving on to the second conditions, those having an increased pulmonary blood flow, those with RV dominance will be hypoplastic left heart syndrome, tricuspid atresia, hypoplastic left heart syndrome, TAPV, total anomalous pulmonary venous communication in single atrium. Those with left ventricular dominance will again be tricuspid atresia with unrestricted pulmonary blood flow, and single ventricle with unrestricted pulmonary blood flow. Those with biventricular dominance again will be here truncus arteriosus. Those conditions which presents with pulmonary edema will be TAPVC and hypoplastic left heart syndrome. And those conditions who are having almost normal pulmonary blood flow will be the miscellaneous group, unroofed coronary sinus into LA, anomalous systemic venous drainage, and pulmonary AV fistula. So we have discussed today in this lecture the approach to congenital heart disease. First of all, how to diagnose congenital heart disease by NADAS criteria. After you have to diagnose, you have to answer the five basic questions which we have just dealt about. And we have seen what are all the cyanotic and the acyanotic congenital heart diseases. We will be now discussing each of the diseases, firstly into groups and then individual diseases, in our next lecture series which will span over days, 2 months, 2 years. So you can put down your doubts to my email ID, which has been written below. Thank you. Have a nice day.